Hey everyone, welcome back to Dietitians and Nutrition Support. Today we're going to be talking about one of my favorite topics, which is nutrition and dietetics research. If you are a student in dietetics or you're a dietitian working and practicing, you have probably at one time or another been asked to or picked up a journal article, research article, manuscript, white paper, whatever you want to call it, but some research about nutrition that helps to inform our evidence-based practice. It's the evidence part of the evidence-based practice. So because that's the standard of care that we want to be providing to our patients, it's really important for us to understand how we even read the evidence to be informing that practice. So today we're going to be breaking down how to read a journal article, including describing what sections are in a journal article and how you might be able to improve the efficiency with which you can do that. So let's go ahead and get started. You're going to see at the top of a research article is typically going to be the title. If you were looking and searching for research articles yourself, I'm sure that you probably read the title already before starting to read the research article. That's the easiest way for us to look for an article that's going to be supportive of whatever information it is that we need to find. The next thing you'll see underneath the title is typically the list of authors. You can have anywhere from one to many different authors on a research article, and that all just depends on the design of the research, what the article might be telling you, if it took a lot of people to be able to do it, if there was collaboration, etc. But anyway, for the most part, it'll have a listing of the authors, typically their qualifications or any certifications that they might have, and it'll also tell you information about their institution, as well as contact information if you're interested in contacting an author who wrote this paper. Underneath of the author's list, you will see a very important section of your journal article, which is the abstract. You may have heard previously of abstracts being submitted for things like poster presentations at a conference without having the rest of the manuscript ready. And abstracts are a really important key to doing something like a poster where you describe the research generally in a very quick fashion, very summary oriented, as well as abstracts are the same kind of thing at the top of a manuscript paper. They're very summary oriented. They want to give you small snippets of information from each of the sections throughout the paper, so that when you read through the end of the anywhere from 200 to about 500 word abstract, you can get really all of the information, the really critical stuff that you're going to be able to read through in more detail in the article. So if you've read through a title of a journal article and you've said, I think that's of interest to me in the topics that I want to know about, the next step is going to be reading that abstract, because again, that abstract is a summary helping to break down all the things that you'd read and understand if you read further into the article. So the abstract can really just kind of boil it down to the main takeaway points, and then you can really get a good thought of, you know, was the abstract interesting? Did it give me information that served the purpose that I need? And then you can make the decision as to whether or not you want to continue to read the entirety of the paper. Now, while reading the abstract is a super important part of being able to decipher if you want to continue to read the rest of the paper, it doesn't always give as much information because it's only like 500 words at the very, very most. It doesn't give all of the information that you're going to get from reading the remainder of the article. So if you think that the information in the abstract is interesting, make sure to continue reading the article so that you can get all the other interesting tidbits that they weren't able to fit in the abstract. Once you get done reading the abstract, and if you've decided to continue reading the paper, the next section that you'll see at the very top is going to be the introduction or the background section. It'll depend on whatever the author wants to call it, but this section is all going to be dedicated on building the argument for the significance of the investigation or the research that they're describing. So this section will tell you all of the previous studies that have maybe investigated and supported this mission. It'll tell you what the author is thinking as to why they chose to do this research or why they wanted to write this paper, and all that background information can be super helpful in making sure that you understand the full picture of what this article is going to be describing, what the issues are, why it's important. There's two important things to know about this background and introduction section. The first thing is it is going to be really important for you to pick up different pieces of information in this section, particularly if you're not super familiar with a topic. So if you need the background info, read the background info. If you're super familiar with a topic, you might find, if you're reading a lot of articles that are on the same topic, that the background information section sounds a little bit repetitive. So if you've read a lot of articles in this area, it may be okay for you to kind of skim this section a little bit more and not necessarily spend all this time reading the same stats or similar stats over and over and over again, because you already know the significance and the reason why this is an important thing to research. The second thing to know about the background and introduction section is that this is a perfect place for you to start picking up other tidbits of information that maybe if you're doing some research or you're writing a research article, these are great citations. They're going to help you also support your arguments, particularly if your argument is related to the research article that you're looking at right now. So this can be a good time to just kind of snag some of those references and maybe put them away for you to read later. Now, to give you a little bit more of a thought of what this actually looks like in the journal article, here's some sections of a support line article that was published in the last few years that talks about implementing blended tube feeding into the clinical setting. So obviously you can see here there's the title of the manuscript, there's a variety of authors and all of their credentials. And here is an example of the abstract section. You can see how short the abstract section is. There's not a lot of words here, but they pack in the detail. And here is an example of some of the introduction section. The introduction section is a little bit longer, so I didn't include it all for you, but hopefully this gives you a good sense of some of the information you might see. Giving general statistics about the problem, describing the significance of the issue, and really helping to build the argument for why this research article is important. Now, while you'll have a title, authors, abstract, and an introduction and background section in pretty much every journal article, after we get past that part, you may see a little bit of a divergence as to what the remainder of the article looks like. So you could see articles that are what I would consider a review article or kind of a description of clinical practice article, and those articles are going to be specifically talking about things that a clinical institution might already be doing, or a general review as to the holistic concerns about a specific topic. And then on the other side of things, you may see articles that are what I would consider an intervention or a study-based article that are actually going to describe something that the researchers did, a research strategy that the researchers used to be able to develop the information that's in the article. So let me describe to you what it looks like to have those kind of two different paths of research articles. So let's start out by considering the content of the paper for a review or a description of practice article. These articles are typically broken into different sections with distinct headers for each section. Normally, these headers are going to be more descriptive than you would see in a methods-based research article, which we'll talk about again in a few minutes. This might show you something like sections related to potentially a specific location of practice. So for example, in the paper that we've already kind of been breaking down the parts for, you can see that we're describing blenderized tube feeding in a variety of different settings. So you'll see different sections here for Johns Hopkins Children's Center or Seattle Children's Hospital. For this paper in particular, that's the primarity of what these sections look like, telling where this was occurring and then describing what's happening. You might also see in this similar type of setup that you would have different section headers that talk about a particular type of practice. Say we're talking about an NG tube, and then maybe the next section we would talk about an NJ tube. So there's various different ways that you can title each section to let the reader know that you're going to be describing those particular topics as you go through. So when you're the reader, then you know exactly what you're looking for and exactly what to expect from each section. Once the researcher has gotten through all of the sections of the paper where they actually want to describe the either review or the clinical practice things that they're talking about, then you'll see a conclusion section at the very end of the article. The conclusion section is super helpful as it often is used to tie in all of what we discussed in the paper. So they'll often reference some of the different sections that they talked about and make sure that the reader at the end of the day, us, understands what was so important about this paper and what take-home messages they should take after reading this paper. The conclusion section typically does not introduce any new information, so it's a very holistic understanding of what you just read. You might also see in the conclusion section that there will be some discussion as to potential areas of other research that could be interesting or recommendations for others who are clinicians to try and implement in their own practice. And once you get to the end of the article, past the conclusion, you will finally see a list of references. So like I already kind of mentioned, the background and information section has typically a lot of good references helping to develop the significance of the problem and why this research article was being written. And throughout the remainder of the paper, you might also see other references to specific citations for other research that the authors drew upon to be able to write their article. This reference section can be a gold mine of different citations that you might want to look into to be able to kind of cherry pick out ones that you're interested in reading that could again support your understanding of this topic. So to give you an example of what some of those might look like, again, here is the conclusion that describes all of the things that we read about in the journal article. And then here's an example of what the references might look like. Both of these sections could be a little bit longer than this. Typically, the references can get pretty long, and particularly for a review paper in which they're oftentimes looking at a lot of different research and combining it all into one paper, you'll often have many, many references to look at. So these lists are much longer, but hopefully this gives you a good sense of what those could look like. Okay, so let's dial back a little bit and go to the other branch or that other type of research article that you might see. So if you're not reading through a review or a description of clinical practice article, you may be reading through an article that has a research strategy. This means that there was some kind of an intervention, an observational study, a something that was done by the researchers in which they collected data or analyzed data or computed across data, did something with data to then be able to produce this manuscript. So just like before, you're still going to have a title, authors, and abstract. The abstract might look a touch different, specifically with this kind of research strategy article, because they're going to try and describe to you the methods that they did for the research article and the results and the conclusions, which we'll talk about in just a sec. So note that the abstract might look a little different, but the abstract will still be there and it will still serve the same purposes, giving you the summary of what you're going to see in this research article so that you can make the best decision as to whether or not you want to continue reading. You'll still have a background and an introduction section that again builds the significance of the problem and describes why they're doing the research, and then we get to the parts that are a little bit different. Typically, after the background and introduction section, you'll see method sections. You might just see one section that's called methods, in which they describe the methods, and you might see multiple sections that talk about the different methods that are used. This can depend on mostly how complicated the different type of research strategy that this author is using. So if there are a lot of different pieces, they typically will break it out into sections, tell you which part they're talking about, and then describe it. So if you don't want to read through a specific section of the methods, you can skip that section and move on to the one that you're really interested in. So once you get past the method section, then you'll start to see the results sections. You might see a little bit of a statistical analysis section somewhere in between there if they're describing the stats in a separate section. But again, they're really just going to tell you what kinds of things that they did for the statistics and not really any other information. So if you get past methods, you get past stats, you get to results. This results section is going to be really important. The results section is where the author is going to state all of the results or the outcomes of the research that they conducted. The sections are going to differ depending on what kind of methodological design that the researcher is using, but typically they're going to describe all of the data that they produced from their research. This is not going to include often any type of opinions or feelings about the results. It's really just going to plainly state those numbers. Sometimes people feel that that can be very useful for them to read through, as it gives them something that they can read that's unbiased. The researcher has not put their own information in there for you to kind of help describe what they think happened, but it can leave you to understand and comprehend the numbers for yourself. So if that's helpful, it could be helpful for you to read the results section. The discussion section is going to describe to you all of the things that happened in the results. so all of the numbers that were produced from this study, and it's typically going to talk about what they think happened, why they think it happened, maybe what happened in other similar research articles and how they might be the same or maybe are contrasting outcomes. And this is going to kind of, you know, continue to build that argument, that not only the argument of, wow, this research was important, but this is what happened, why it happened, why we think it happened, and what other people saw as well, to kind of keep developing the sense of what the actual outcomes were for the paper. So let's look at a different support line article that has a research strategy in it so that we can see how this might differ a little bit when writing up the manuscript. So this article is called The Feasibility of Nutrition-Focused Physical Exam in an Intensive Care Unit. You can tell here that under the title we have one author, and then we have that abstract section, that summary section, telling us what to anticipate in this article. Following that, we have that introduction section, and then we get to the part that it differs a little bit. So you can see here there's a fairly short method section that's going to describe all of the things that this researcher did to understand how feasible it was to do a nutrition-focused physical exam within the ICU. You can also see that in this method section, she included the descriptive statistics pieces that were used. After we got through that section, we get to that results piece, which are those non-biased reports of what happened and the outcomes. And you can see here also that we have this full discussion section in which we'll see the author reference not only the results of their own study, but also results of other studies to develop a dialogue about what actually is occurring when everyone else is looking at nutrition-focused physical exams in the ICU. Then you'll see that this comes, just like the other articles, to a conclusion section. And in that conclusion section, you'll see, again, the description of all the things that happened in the article in a conclusive manner, and typically some little bits of direction as to what the next things might be that this author is going to research, or things that they feel that other researchers should pursue. And at the very, very end of this article, just the same as the other type of articles, you see those references. Another important thing to note about journal articles is that it's not just words, sometimes you get pictures. So you'll see figures and tables also included in research articles oftentimes. These are super important because after you've read the title and the abstract and you've said to yourself, I think I'm going to read this paper, I sometimes like to skim down to the results or the discussion section and look for the figures, because the figures and tables are typically going to describe to you the most important takeaways that your author wants you to get from reading all of those sections. All right, so here's my last few tips for reading through research articles. Remember, when you're reading a research article, that skimming is your friend. You don't have to read every single line with excruciating focus. It's okay for you to say, I really need to prioritize some sections over other sections. And you're going to know that probably better than I as to what information you're really trying to grasp from an article. If you've ever read a research article, you probably already know this, but highlighting specific sections and writing notes to yourself about what you highlighted can be a super helpful way to make sure that you keep understanding what's going on throughout the article. These notes are also really important if you put the article down and come back to it a few days later and you're like, what was this about? So leave notes for your future self. And one final push for the references section. I've kind of already mentioned it, but references are a gold mine when it comes to things to look at in the future. So if you want to have more things to read after you read your one article, go through the references, read through some titles, and go look up some other papers and see what you can get for other information that might support your particular research interests. Hopefully this video has been a helpful breakdown as to what different types of research articles you might see in nutrition and dietetics research, as well as the different sections you could anticipate seeing if you're reading those research articles. If you want to see more videos about reading through research articles or even evaluating which ones are good, etc., please feel free to leave comments about that in the boxes below. And until then, we'll see you next time.